All right, so this is going to be kind of a short video, but I wanted to get it out there because earlier this week, Adobe did release updates to Lightroom as well as Photoshop for the iPad. Now, with Lightroom, this is going to be about the changes to Lightroom Desktop. They did release updates to Lightroom Mobile as well as Lightroom Classic. Those were more kind of new camera and lens profile stuff. Lightroom Desktop actually got a few new features and changes that I think is worth covering. The reason why I'm also including Photoshop for the iPad is because when I recorded and released my video earlier this week that showed how you can use the new generative fill tools that were built into Lightroom, at that time, they didn't have Generative Expand. Generative Expand is when you use the crop tool to expand your image and then you use the generative fill to fill the extra space in. You could do it, but in the video that I released, I showed you the more manual way. Now, Generative Expand is built in. I'll show you really quickly how to use it because it's super cool. So let's get right in. All right, so let's start with Lightroom on the desktop. And the first thing you'll obviously want to do is install the update to the app. And the easiest way to do that is to go to your Creative Cloud app over here, click on the apps icon, and then go to updates. And if you don't see anything, just click on this check for updates button. It'll check to see if there are any new versions. And you should see, depending on the apps you have installed, you'll see an update for Classic, for Lightroom, and any other app. So make sure you install those first. With that done, you can close out of the Creative Cloud app. And then when you first launch Lightroom, you'll be greeted with this dialog box. And it shows you that there are three primary changes. Now I'm gonna focus on batch reset and the geometry and crop changes. There is also screen reader support if you use that accessibility function. But again, for this video, I'm sticking with batch reset and geometry and crop. All right, let's start with batch reset, which you might not think is a big deal until you need it. So let me show you what I mean there. Here are a bunch of photos I took with my iPhone from my parents' balcony last week. And let's say I want to stitch these 9 photos into a panel, which is what I want to do. But I want to make the edits to the images first. So I can open up this first image here, and I'm just going to click on auto and apply a quick S-curve just so that we can see the changes to the image. Then I'll go to grid and I will press Command or Control C to copy those edit changes. I will then select the rest of the images and press Command or Control V to paste them. And so you can see that those edits are being pasted to the remaining 8 photos. Now, let's say I decide, you know what, that's actually not the treatment I'm going for, I want to start over. Well, before, you'd have to reset each image separately. There is kind of a trick there where you can basically reset this first photo, and you can do that by pressing Command or Control R, and then following the same trick that I just showed you, you would copy the changes, the edit changes, and then paste them. Now though, all you need to do is select the images that you want to reset. You can right click, and then at the very bottom, you'll see reset edits in 9 photos. You can also use the keyboard shortcut, Command R or Control R. So I'll go ahead and do that. And you'll see this dialog box that's showing. It is basically resetting everything to the settings on import. Now you might be wondering why the images look so bad when they were reset. And that's just because the profile, the default profile that was applied as Adobe Standard, if you apply Apple ProRAW, which is what I use to take these photos, it looks a lot better. So again, now I can go ahead and copy this and then select the remaining photos and paste them. And this is effectively now going to be at kind of the default starting state. So again, not a huge change, but something that's at least worth knowing that you can do. So you can select multiple photos and reset them to their original states. Now let's move on to the geometry tool. So this is actually pretty straightforward. Nothing changed in terms of the tool except where it can be found. So if I open up an image here, before, if you wanted to use the geometry tool to correct for perspective or distortion, you'd open the image up and then you'd go to the edit tools. And then when you scroll to the bottom, there would be a geometry section here. But notice it is not here anymore. That's because it was moved to the crop tool. So when you click on crop, you'll now see there is a geometry section. So when you click on the disclosure triangle, you'll see you have your tools. You can also expand the subsection here to have more of the fine grained tools that if you want to adjust specifically distortion or vertical or horizontal, that's all there. And so those are the two primary changes to Lightroom Desktop that I wanted to cover. Again, not massive, but these are quality of life improvements. I like that they move geometry to crop because The edit panel was getting very busy, especially when you add in all of the other sub panels. And so geometry is typically something you do when you're cropping. At least that's how I always work with it. So to me, it makes more sense. Now let's move on to Photoshop on the iPad. Like I mentioned in my previous video, that version of Photoshop had generative fill, but it did not have generative expand. So it kind of saves you a step or two, which I'm a big fan of. So let me show you how that works. All right, so just like on the desktop, the first thing you'll want to do is install the latest version of Photoshop. So you can go to the App Store over here. And you can see under what's new there, we have Generative Expand. That was not there when I recorded my video. And you can see this version of the app was updated 3 days ago. So you'll want to install that first, and then you tap on the Photoshop icon to load it. So I've got an image already opened over here. And before, what I'd have to do is I would use the crop tool to adjust the crop and then use this rectangular marquee tool to make selections of that extra space and fill it in. Now it's so much easier, and it's now in line with how you would do it on Photoshop for the desktop. So what you'll do is you'll tap on the crop tool here. Let me pinch in a little bit so we could see a bit more of it. And let's just say I want to expand it like this. I just want to add a little bit more along the top and the left and right. You'll now see a button on the left there. It says Generative Expand. So what you'll do is tap on that. And if the only thing you want to do is expand the canvas, you'll leave this text box blank and you'll tap on Generate. And you can see it did a seamless job of expanding the canvas. I think it's so cool the way it works. And as with any other generative fill task, you see you have three different thumbnails on the bottom right there, three different variations to choose the one that works best for you. That first one is great, so I would just stick with that. All right, so those are the updates that Adobe added to Lightroom Desktop as well as Photoshop for the iPad. Not massive changes, but important to know in case you want to add them to your workflows. And if you want to learn everything there is to know about Lightroom's cloud-based ecosystem and how to use it on the desktop and mobile, please check out my course called Lightroom Everywhere. Links in the description below. If you want to continue your video watching journey, check out this playlist over here. A thumbs up always helps if you enjoyed this video and you found it helpful. And please hit the subscribe button and the bell icon to be notified for all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.